and today I'm baking through history in my modern kitchen. I'm going to be trying bread roll recipes, baking as if it were the 1750s, 1850s, and 1950s. Well, first of all, for the recipes from the 1700s and 1800s, they call for ale yeast. I only could find beer, so let's roll with it. We're gonna start with a cup of flour. So I'm weighing the yeast mixture that I'm making so that I know exactly how to divide it for my three recipes, which is more precise than any 18th century cook would probably do it. And then 2 tablespoons of yeast. So this recipe is from the Cook and Confectioner's Dictionary, published in 1723, with the fourth edition being in 1733. The author is John Nott, and he was a kind of cook or chef to aristocrats in England. Who was following a recipe very precisely in those days? The recipes weren't even very precise, so I'm going to use a cook's intuition. I'm going to add 1/2 tablespoon of salt, because it didn't ask for salt. We are then going to whisk all the dry ingredients together. Okay, so here we have the flour with some salt surreptitiously added in that the recipe didn't call for. We have the ale yeast, we have some fat and egg and milk and water. So this paddle is invaluable to me. If I'm traveling back in time, this is coming with me, the one thing I need. Okay, so let's make a well in the center of the flour, and then we're gonna add in the yeast. The recipe only calls for a spoonful, but I know it's going to take forever. They didn't use a lot of yeast back then. I'm just going to use a judicious amount. We will just pretend that I had a little bit too much Danish beer and slopped in more yeast than needed. I always break the egg separately because once there was a rotten egg that ruined my entire chocolate cake. We're only going to basically need 1/2 of it, but I'm just going to guesstimate. We're going to just guess about 1/2 water and 1/2 milk. The recipe calls for suet, and I don't have any, so I'm just going to use some lard. And that's all, just a teeny weensy bit. Then just 1 ounce of butter, not very much at all. I don't actually want to stick my hands in because it's just like wasteful when you get dough stuck to your hand. But you know what? Let's just do it. Fun. It's just like I always hate getting that dough stuck and all that. Counter is a little high. The 18th century bread dough has been rising for 100 years, so it's about time we shaped it into a loaf and baked it. This is what I usually do, fold in half and half again, and then I push it away from me and fold it back. And so this is the 18th century bread. We have a loaf and 6 dinner rolls. Now we are going to test a recipe for nice buns from the Virginia Housewife or Methodical Cook by Mary Randolph. This edition is from 1838. So we'll have 1 ounce of whole wheat flour and then 5 ounces of normal all-purpose flour. Now some of our yeast mixture. Now some milk. Here's where we get a little bit newfangled. I'm gonna stuff in there, and it's a nice soft dough, which is what I like when making buns. So Mary Randolph has a recipe that I'm quite curious about. She cooks cornmeal in water to make a gruel, then she says add flour and salt and yeast and make a loaf with it. She says indifferent flour will rise much better when made with gruel than with fair water. She doesn't say how much cornmeal, so I'm gonna go with 3 tablespoons. Two cups of flour. Finally, a recipe that calls for salt. To the flour mixture, I added some of my ale yeast mixture, the cornmeal gruel, and then I started kneading and mixing it into dough. Now, I needed to add some water here and there just to make sure it came together. I was aiming for a soft, slightly sticky dough, so I didn't really knead it with my hands because I knew it would be too sticky. I usually find things when they're a little softer tend to rise well and become pretty fluffy. I let both doughs rise for an hour, then I prepared and greased my pans and measured out some butter to add to the nice buns. The dough was very, very soft and light. The butter, once I started kneading it in, kind of made the dough even softer, so I think that I really needed a little bit more flour than what I had here. But you know what? All this is a matter of, you know, experimentation and learning.
I divided the dough into 6 equal portions, and then I put a little bit of flour on my work surface just to work a little bit of flour into the dough as I shaped it, seeing as it was a little bit soft and floppy. Then I brushed it with more of my egg and milk mixture. Once the mixed bread dough was risen, I poured it onto my work surface. It was very soft, so I used some flour to shape it, folding it into thirds twice and then pinching and sealing the ends, then transferring it to my loaf tin. In this case, having a really, really soft dough was a huge advantage and made the bread rise so well, as you will soon see. I slashed the loaf, and then after half an hour, both breads were ready to bake. So we come to the end of today's adventure, and I am so blown away at how delicious a recipe from like 400 years ago could be. I'm definitely going to be baking and cooking more from history, so stay tuned. Do like, subscribe, and join me again on another adventure. Bye!